This is the first layer in the consciousness iceberg, a project where we'll explain consciousness from several distinct angles, including the latest theories from the academy, such as integrated information theory, or Yosha Bock's theories, or panpsychism, but as well as other traditions like what the Vedic texts say, or the different schools of Buddhism, and we'll even explore altered states of consciousness. All of this will be done in a rigorous fashion, similar to the string theory iceberg, which you can check out, and the link is in the description. For those who are unfamiliar, the iceberg format is one where you initially explore preparatory surface-level concepts, then progress ever more into the intricacies of a topic, which tend to be known only to a specialized few, until you eventually arrive at the obscure, dark frontiers of the deepest layers of the field of consciousness in this case. My name is Kurt Jaimungal, and I use my background in mathematical physics to analyze theories of everything, but today we have a consciousness iceberg which is heavily inspired by Robert Lawrence Kuhn's comprehensive behemoth article on consciousness, which I recommend you check out. The link is in the description. Robert Lawrence Kuhn, by the way, is the host of the series Closer to Truth and has a series specifically on consciousness in there. And that link is also in the description. Check them both out. I can't recommend them highly enough. Now let's begin with the first layer, an introduction to consciousness. Layer 1, an introduction to consciousness. What is consciousness? Consciousness is the state of being aware and responsive to one's surroundings. It encompasses a range of mental phenomena, including thoughts, including feelings, sensations, perceptions, etc. Note that many conversations about consciousness get stuck as soon as someone asks, "Hey, what's the definition you're using?" Now, the reason is that even with what I just said or what anyone will say, consciousness is defined with words circularly. This is the case with anything that doesn't straightforwardly map to something physical. Now, there are physical theories of consciousness, and we're going to explore pretty much every single one of them in the subsequent layers, and we're also going to explore pretty much every single one of the non-physical theories as well. But the issue is that you could always say, "Okay, well, what do you mean by mental phenomenon? What do you mean by thoughts? What's the definition of feelings? What about sensations? What's the definition of a perception or a qualia?" If you were to try to provide a definition, they'll be explicated with further words, and the clever person can just remark, "Hey, what do you mean by those words?" So, in order to make progress, we're just going to have to move beyond this and provide analogies. Most people think of consciousness broadly as either a spotlight or a stream. Now, the spotlight people will say that it illuminates. Consciousness illuminates a small part of some vast landscape of mental activity, whereas the stream people will say consciousness is like a flowing stream of thoughts, feelings, and sensations. What's an uncontroversial statement is that consciousness is what allows you to experience the world, and most would say, by the way, that consciousness is not identical to those experiences. Rather, it's what allows those experiences to be experienced. It's also tied to choice and thus to free will. Now, the question naturally occurs, why the heck does consciousness matter? And the answer then immediately jumps out, well, it's the foundation of your being. It's what makes you who you are. But there are some challenges. The challenges are that defining consciousness is notoriously difficult, as we've mentioned. Number two, explaining consciousness. We don't have an understanding of how consciousness comes about from, say, the physical processes of the brain, or if it indeed comes about in that fashion. And number three, measuring consciousness. It's proven quite challenging to measure consciousness objectively. The mind-body problem. The mind-body problem is an issue I'm sure you've heard referenced plenty. It's about various questions regarding how the mind, which seems immaterial, relates to the body, which appears material, or at least physical, as some say. Some people, like Chomsky, have called consciousness a ghost in the machine. More specifically, the mind is like a ghost that inhabits the machine of the body. I've actually spoken to Chomsky more than any other independent podcast 10 times, and you can see it here in the description as well as on screen, on the topics of philosophy and consciousness. Others think that there is no mind-body problem because both are aspects of the same reality. Either all is mind, or all is matter, or both mind and matter are examples of some third yet unexplicated type. The film The Matrix explores the possibility that our reality is some computer simulation, which is something that we discuss on this channel, and examples are here on screen in the description as well with David Chalmers and Scott Aronson. The Matrix is directly about the mind-body problem. How is it that your consciousness can be so different from what you perceive of as your body? Ghosts in movies also address this dualism. Dualism, by the way, just means twoism. In this case, it references the different aspects that we've heard here of both mind and body. Or some people call it spirit and matter. Or some other people call it consciousness and the concrete. With spirits and ghosts in films, what they're conveying is this concept that something disembodied is interacting with the physical world around it. This quote-unquote interaction problem is exactly this. How, and I mean exactly how, does the mind and the body causally interact, given their ostensibly separate nature? Are they not as separate as we thought? There's also, by the way, the twin union problem, which concerns how so-called joining a mind to a body gives rise to this mind-body union that we call a human being, aka you. Sleep, dreams, and altered states. Sleep, dreams, and altered states of consciousness represent deviations from our usual waking state. These experiences involve shifts in brain activity, alterations of perception, and differences in awareness. Sleeps and dreams, for instance, can be likened to journeys into some other realm of consciousness, while altered states can be seen as windows into some hidden depth of the mind. Concretely speaking, sleep is exigent for both physical and mental health, playing a role in memory consolidation and emotional processing. Dreams are often bizarre and nonsensical, as you may well know, and many think that they're some expression of our subconscious mind or mechanism for strengthening memories. As for lucid dreaming, we'll speak about that in a later layer of this consciousness iceberg, so subscribe to get notified. Altered states, such as those that are experienced, let's say, during meditation or some religious ceremonies, or under the influence of psychedelics, are said to inspire creativity and self-discovery. Now, creativity has been demonstrated in the psychological literature, but self-discovery is a bit trickier as there's not a consensus on the definition of that word, and what you're discovering may not be yourself, but maybe something that you perceive as yourself. These altered states may even enhance spiritual understanding. So some altered states, like near-death experiences, by the way, put pressure on materialistic views of consciousness by suggesting that our awareness may extend beyond the mere physical. Freud, by the way, saw dreams as wish fulfillment. That is to say, you have some hidden goals or some hidden wishes or instincts, and you want to fulfill them in a playground that isn't tied to material reality. Again, if there is a material reality. So perhaps it's better stated as waking reality, especially as these goals and instincts and wishes are given to you by a subconscious. Now, there are some problems here that are left outstanding. So why do dreams have such strange content? What is the relationship between the conscious and the subconscious mind? And lastly, are altered states merely illusions, or do they provide access to genuine realities? Free will versus determinism. The debate over free will versus determinism tends to center on whether our choices are actually free, chosen by us, or predetermined by some prior event/events. For those who are unfamiliar, determinism is like being on a train where you have a set track and you can't deviate from it. Furthermore, you can only move forward. Whereas free will is akin to, let's say, a choose-your-own-adventure book, where you have the power to select between different potentials, making one of those potentials into some actuality. The reason this debate has been popular for thousands of years is that it has implications for our responsibility, our morality, our consciousness, and even God. An example would be, if our choices are predetermined, well, can we ever be held morally responsible? If so, how? If not, why? Also, does consciousness grant us the power to make free choices? Is that the role of consciousness? What is the role of consciousness? Again, this whole free will versus determinism, as well as sleeps, dreams, lucid dreaming, altered states, mind-body, consciousness, etc., all of these will be talked to in greater length in subsequent layers. This is just the introductory layer to this iceberg. Now, several issues come about when discussing free will. For instance, explaining consciousness is one. If our choices aren't caused by prior events, then what causes them? Neuroscientific evidence suggests that our decisions are influenced by brain activity. Are they solely determined by them? Many physicists argue that the feeling of free will is a mere illusion, whereas many philosophers say that that's just one definition of free will. There are other definitions, such as one that is compatible with determinism called compatibilism. The self and identity. The self is the sense of being a distinct individual with your own unique history, your personality, and your set of experiences. Identity is the continuity of the self across time. This is one of the ways that, in Buddhism, it's misrepresented by saying that the self is an illusion. Yes, Buddhist texts do emphasize that, but what they mean by illusion isn't that the self is false or identity is false, but rather that identity and the self change and are not persistent across time. You can still have this continuity, though. Much like Heraclitus with the river, even if it's a different river, you can still call it a river. The self is central to consciousness. It allows us to have a first-person perspective and experience ourselves, self-consciousness, as agents. Our sense of self is the basis of something called personhood, which enables moral responsibility, and it also gives our lives meaning and purpose. Introspection, as well as self-awareness, are aspects that are discussed frequently when people reference the concept of the self. Introspection means looking inward at your own thoughts, your own feelings, your own experiences, while self-awareness is about being conscious of yourself as a distinct individual. However, some argue that the self is an illusion, just a construct of the brain. Some of these people will explore later, like Daniel Dennett, Yosha Bock, Michael Graziano, as well as the religious canon of Buddhism and the Vedas. Something else that naturally creeps up is the question of personal identity over time. What makes you the same person, even if at every instant your body and your mind changes? What is it? What is that core nugget that keeps you, you? And also, what is the nature of self-knowledge? If there is this Kantian distinction where we can't ever truly know the world, the noumena, as he calls it, but rather we can only ever know phenomena, well then, can you ever truly know yourself? How do we truly know who we are? Firstly, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. There's now a website, KurtJaimungal.org, and that has a mailing list. The reason being that large platforms like YouTube, like Patreon, they can disable you for whatever reason, whenever they like. That's just part of the terms of service. Now, a direct mailing list ensures that I have an untrammeled communication with you. Plus, soon I'll be releasing a one-page PDF of my top 10 toes. It's not as Quentin Tarantino as it sounds like. Secondly, if you haven't subscribed or clicked that like button, now is the time to do so. Why? Because each subscribe, each like helps YouTube push this content to more people like yourself. Plus, it helps out Kurt directly, aka me. I also found out last year that external links count plenty toward the algorithm, which means that whenever you share on Twitter, say on Facebook or even on Reddit, etc., it shows YouTube, hey, people are talking about this content outside of YouTube, which in turn greatly aids the distribution on YouTube. Thirdly, there's a remarkably active Discord and subreddit for Theories of Everything, where people explicate toes, they disagree respectfully about theories, and build as a community our own toe. Links to both are in the description. Fourthly, you should know this podcast is on iTunes, it's on Spotify, it's on all of the audio platforms. All you have to do is type in Theories of Everything and you'll find it. Personally, I gained from rewatching lectures and podcasts. I also read in the comments that, hey, toe listeners also gain from replaying. So how about instead you re-listen on those platforms like iTunes, Spotify, Google Podcasts, whichever podcast catcher you use. And finally, if you'd like to support more conversations like this, more content like this, then do consider visiting patreon.com/KurtJMungle and donating with whatever you like. There's also PayPal. There's also crypto. There's also just joining on YouTube. Again, keep in mind, it's support from the sponsors and you that allow me to work on TOE full time. You also get early access to ad-free episodes, whether it's audio or video. It's audio in the case of Patreon, video in the case of YouTube. For instance, this episode that you're listening to right now was released a few days earlier. Every dollar helps far more than you think. Either way, your viewership is generosity enough. Thank you so much.